Okay. Before we have the bishop's presentation tonight, we're going to bless the icon that will go with KCDM 98.3. Listen to it. We're going to bless the icon that will go on the outside wall there.
Okay. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace and peace of God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ, the image of the unseen God, be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, we have genuine reason to rejoice because we are about to bless the image of our Lord Jesus Christ to be erected for veneration. This image honors above all the truth that Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. The eternal Son of God who came down to the womb of the Virgin Mary is the sign and sacrament of God the Father. As Christ himself said, "He who sees me sees the Father." Therefore, when we honor this image, let us lift up our eyes to Christ, who reigns forever with the Father and the Holy Spirit. Somebody reading?
Yep, he's coming.
Oh, good.
Brothers and sisters, listen to the words of the Apostle Paul to the Corinthians. Give thanks to the Father, who has made you fit to share in the inheritance of the holy ones in light. He delivered us from the power of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him were created all things in heaven and on earth, the visible and the invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead. And in all things, he himself might be preeminent. For in him all fullness was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile all things for him, making peace by the blood of his cross through him, whether those on earth or those in heaven.
Lord, although your glory lies beyond our sight, out of your great love you have revealed yourself in the person of Christ. May those who have crafted this image of your Son show him honor by growing in his likeness, who is Lord forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your minds and hearts in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Lord Jesus Christ, now and forever.
Amen.
And may Almighty God bless all of you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Good. That's beautiful. Okay, you know, popes throughout the years have dedicated years to something. We had the year of priests, we had the year of the rosary, we had the year of the Eucharist, we had the year of the scriptures. But a Jubilee year is different. And it has its origins, of course, in the Old Testament. God created, and on the seventh day, he rested. And so every 7 years, there was a time of rest for the Israelites. But then every seven times seven, every 49 years, the 50th year was a Jubilee year. And so we've had Jubilee years in the church. What they ended up doing with ordinary, the ones like the rosary and the Eucharist that are just individual years. But the Jubilee year comes every 25 or 50 years. They wanted to make sure that everybody in their lifetime had a chance to live through one Jubilee year. And so the last Jubilee year was in the year 2000. And it marked, of course, the 2,000 years since the birth of Christ and also the millennium. But the last one was 2000. There might be one in 2025 or 2050. But an extraordinary Jubilee, which is what this one is, it's not fitting into the 25, 50 years. They have an extraordinary Jubilee year mark something significant. So the last extraordinary Jubilee year we had was in 1983. And that John Paul called that year. And it marked the 1,950th year since the death and resurrection of Jesus. And so Pope Francis, he has such a passion for God's love for us and the fact that we need to share that love with others, that I'm not surprised that he decided to declare an extraordinary year for something very extraordinary and special, and that's, of course, is God's mercy. And so this is an outstanding event of importance. It's very different than just a year dedicated to something, and it's very different than an ordinary year of Jubilee. This is the extraordinary year. I can't remember any of these that had the same impact that this extraordinary Jubilee year seems to be having on people. There just seems to be an excitement about it, even for all of you to come together for having this weekend of mercy. I think of all of the listening to the priests when they're the confessions that they're hearing. I've done a couple of the communal penance services. The number of people that are showing up for it, looking at even other dioceses, what they're doing. It's just a marvelous thing, and it's a. God's mercy, the year, is a twofold thing. It's vertical and it's horizontal. It's a celebration of God's mercy toward us, but then we're supposed to be showing mercy to others. Now, that said, I'm not going to talk directly about mercy. I think that's been done a lot. And besides that just becomes a heady thing to think about. So what I'd rather do is talk about how can we encounter God in Christ. In the fourth Eucharistic prayer, it speaks of God dwelling in unapproachable light. I mean, God is totally, totally other than we are. It's in unapproachable light. But out of God's love and mercy for us, He sent His Son into the world to be the image, the icon. Those who have seen the Son have seen the Father. So what I want to talk about is seeing the Son so that we will see the merciful Father. At Mass, it was the beloved disciple who recognized Jesus on the shore, who recognized the icon of the Father's love. I think I'd like to find, to look at a way to see us finding the Son and being able to point Him out. There's a story about a wealthy couple, and they were giving a cocktail party, and there was a very famous actor who had been invited, and the old grandmother was also there. And so they asked the actor to recite something for them. And so we recited the Psalms, 23rd Psalm, "The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want." And when he was done, everybody applauded. It was very, very nice. He said, "But I want somebody else to also say that Psalm." And the grandmother, he wanted her to say the 23rd Psalm. And when she was finished, there was absolute dead silence. And he said, "I know the 23rd Psalm, she knows the shepherd." And that's kind of what we want to do. We don't want to know about Jesus. We don't want to know about God. We want to know Jesus, and we want to know God. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how we might get to know the shepherd. It's a little bit about prayer. It's a little bit about a very specific type of prayer. I'm sure some of you have done it and heard about it, Lectio Divina, divine reading. How can you read the scriptures in a way that you pray over them? And that's what I'm going to kind of talk about tonight, I hope. Prayer can be a number of things. I mean, I can pray very, very, very intensely when my gas tank is on empty. I can. Oh, God, if you just let me make it there, you know. There is the story about somebody trying to find a parking place at the mall, and they're driving around and driving around. And finally, they says, if I find a parking place, I'll go to Mass every day this week. Right then, this car pulls out. The person said, never mind, I found one myself. St. John Damascene said, prayer is the lifting up of one's mind and heart to God, or requesting of good things from God. So when we decide to pray, we're already at prayer. And God is the one who has called us to prayer. So ultimately, prayer is a response. God has called me to prayer. I decide I'm going to pray, so I'm now giving a response to this God who has called me to prayer, and then the lifting up of my mind and my heart to God. There's a lot that's been written about prayer, but the ultimate goal is to pray. We as Catholics have a rich tradition and storehouse of ways to pray. Probably the first and foremost is our liturgical prayer. The liturgy of the Eucharist, the liturgy of the hours. It's the summit and the source of every of our spiritual life. It's mercy received and mercy given, mercy lived. And from that flows works of charity, stewardship, community. But we have to have, before you can come to liturgical prayer, and flowing from it is personal and private prayer. And that's where we have a wealth of ways. We have devotional prayers like the rosary. We have spontaneous prayers. When I was driving here today, it was raining, and then it was sunny, and then there were these, I could see the rain coming down, and I could see sun shining. It was just absolutely gorgeous. And it was very easy to be at prayer about, Lord, this is just magnificent, what all this stuff that's going on all around me. So that's spontaneous prayer, formal prayer, saying a morning offering, contemplative prayer, centering prayer, charismatic prayer, meditative prayer, communal prayer, intercessory prayer. But these are ways to pray. They are not prayer. They create the place where prayer can take place. In the introduction to the Devout Life by St. Francis de Sales, he said, I say that devotion must be practiced in different ways by the nobleman and by the working man, by the servant and by the priest, by the widow, by the unmarried girl and the married woman. Devotion must be adapted to the strength, to the occupation, and the duties of each one in particular. So not everybody needs to pray the same way. And some of it has to do with our own being. Some people could sit very quietly. Other people couldn't sit quietly at all. So some people, a vocal, charismatic prayer group is where they want. For other ones, they want to come before the Blessed Sacrament and just be quiet. So our own personalities will dictate particular type of prayer. And our circumstance, you know, a mother with four kids is not going to pray the same way a nun does in a convent. It just ain't going to happen. But When I taught in the seminary for 10 years and had a number of the seminarians for spiritual direction, and part of the my role as I saw it then was to help them learn these different ways to pray so that they will pray. So these different, to talk about what's your devotional life like. Have you ever thought of going to a charismatic prayer group? Have you done any kind of meditation? To help them experience these different forms of prayer. What happened, I think, ultimately, was to realize that we need to expand our ways of praying. You can get it. Sometimes you need a formal prayer. You're very arid, nothing's coming, you can't think about anything. Well, maybe that's when you need, you know, to say the memorare or to say the rosary. But maybe there's another time when you really need to focus on things that are going on and finding God in the things around you. One way is to encounter the divine is through the scriptures. You know, we say there's a real presence of Jesus in the Eucharist, but we also say there's a real presence of Jesus in the Word. So you can't take the Eucharist home. I can. I have a chapel in my house. You can't, though. Not without my permission, and I'm not giving it. So you can't have the Eucharist there, but you can have the Scriptures there. If that's a real presence and this is a real presence, then that's a great place to start praying, with the real presence of God's Word, so that you're going to encounter the Word with a small W in order to encounter the Word with a capital W. In the Catechism of the Catholic Church, it says, "The Church forcefully and specially exhorts all the Christian faithful to learn the surpassing knowledge of Jesus Christ by frequent reading of divine scripture. Let them remember, however, that prayer should accompany the reading of sacred scripture so that a dialogue takes place between God and us. For we speak to him when we pray, we listen to him when we read." Before I talk about Lexio, about how we're going to read the scriptures, let me just give a little tiny thing on the scriptures themselves. Obviously, this book is different than any other book. It's the Word of God in human words. It's a collection of books written over hundreds of years. It's a library. It's got religious history, it's got stories, it's got poetry, it's got gospel parable, it's got all kinds of literature in it. And it's not a history book, it's a prayer book. And there's two approaches to scripture. The first one is, what is the text saying? This is God's word to us. And we call that the literal meaning of a passage. And the literal meaning doesn't mean literally what this says. It means, what is it saying? So, you know, I can say, you should see this turkey that came into my office this morning. You know, well, it wasn't a turkey that came in, and you know that, you know. So the literal meaning is this person who was off the wall. Well, they really weren't off the wall, but this person who was off the wall came into my office. And when you read scripture, you have to look at the literary form. What's a parable is different than some of the poetry that's in there, which is different than some of the religious history that's in there. And we read everything else knowing its literary form. So, for example, in the newspaper, if there's a political cartoon, you know how to read that political cartoon. You don't take it as history. They're making fun of something about someone. Read the sports page, and it says, and they buried the Red Sox. Well, if you take it literally or fundamentalistly, you say, well, why would they do that? You know, but if you know how to read the literature, it makes all the sense in the world. And so the same thing with the scriptures. So what is God's word saying to us? The second way, though, is what is God saying to me in this passage? I like to look at it as a window and a mirror. First way you look at it always is as a window. You're looking up into heaven. God is there, and this what is God saying? But the second way is as a mirror. What's God saying to me in this particular passage? And that brings us then to divine reading. There are most people will say there's five steps to divine reading: preparation, reading, meditation, prayer, and contemplation. I like the Latin: preparatio, lectio, meditatio, ratio, and contemplatio. but we're going to take each one of those and try and pull it apart. So, preparation. If you want to listen to the radio, you first of all need to have one. So that would be our faith. You know, we want to listen to God. But then you have to turn the radio on. That's disposing ourselves, getting ourselves ready. And then you need to quiet out all the other noises. Have you ever been at a wedding reception, and the band is playing behind you, and you're sitting at this table, and you're trying to talk to somebody at the other side of the table, and by the time you're finished, you haven't heard a word that was said because there's so much noise, so much external noise going on. And we've kind of learned, I think, because our whole world is full of noise, how to tune out things. We can do it real easily. And so part of preparation is getting ourselves ready to listen to God speak. Well, one of my favorite passages in the Old Testament is 1 Kings 19. That's where Elijah is up on the mountain, and he's waiting for God to pass by. And there's a big thunderstorm, and he runs outside waiting to see God. There's lightning, he runs outside ready to see God. And there's a windstorm, and he runs outside and getting ready to see God. And God's not there. But finally, God was there in a gentle whisper. And it says, and he hid his face because God was passing by. And I do think that sometimes our life is so full of noise that we miss the gentle whisper of God speaking. Sometimes the station just isn't broadcasting. So you can sit down, and I can sit down and pray, and there's nothing, absolutely nothing. My theory is that I still go to prayer then, because that's where I'm learning God's voice, so that when he does speak to me in some event in my day, I'm going to hear him. And in order to do that, in order to have preparatio, preparation, they talk very seriously about needing sacred time and sacred place. Basil Pennington was a Trappist monk, very much into centering prayer. And he said, I think to have a place is important. I speak of it even before the question of time, because making the time, and note I say making the time, we don't just find time, we have to have some place to spend it. So in a monastery, they call their room a cell. A monk goes to his cell. And it comes from the Latin caelum, heaven. And it's the place in heaven where the pagans used to discern the will of God. And so the monks see themselves going to their cell, this place in heaven, where they can listen to God speak to them. So you have to learn to quiet ourselves down. So often we rush into church, we're scattered, we're fragmented, we plop down in the pew, and our minds are all over the place, and we wonder why we can't pray. Well, we need to find ways to quiet ourselves. Now, some people will do a mantra. I like the Jesus prayer, Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. And just to keep repeating that, Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I find that after I've done that 10 or 15 times to be very, very relaxing, very, very quieting. Some people like to burn a candle. Some people like to listen to music. Some people do breathing. Some people can find the rosary to be very calming. But it's a preliminary step. Sometimes you can come to it more quickly. You don't need a lot of times. And other times, almost all of your prayer time is going to be preparation. You can't skip the step, though. You can't skip it. And then to have a sacred place. My habit, I'm an early riser, 4:45, 5 o'clock. I'm up and I'm all wide awake and everything. My day goes on, I go down more and more and more. You're getting close to the end of my day. I got news for you. But my thing is, I go and have my coffee and I read the newspaper. And I'm usually in the office by, maybe 6:30, 6:45, I'm in the office. Nobody's there. It's wonderful. And I have one chair. Well, I have two chairs, but one chair that I use for prayer at that time. And so I go there, and that's where I usually start by saying my office, the prayers that we're supposed to say. I'm one of these people. My office is immaculate. I'm very fastidious about that. If I went into my office and there were stacks of papers and books all over the place, I'd have to clean it up before I could begin to pray. But because this is my prayer place, I can sit down there and I don't have to worry about any of my surroundings, because it's always the same surroundings. And it's just the perfect place for me to sit and pray. So it's someplace in your house. It doesn't have to be any place special. Well, it is, you make it special. That's the whole idea, to make it a special place of prayer. And then to have a sacred time. I'm going to spend 10 minutes before I go to work. I'm going to spend 15 minutes at the end of the day. And that's where you got to go with what's inside of you. I could never do it at night. No way. I'm just too tired. That's it. I don't pray at night. But the morning, I'm fine. I could do it. Some people in the middle of the day can stop and take 10, 15, 20 minutes and be at prayer. First step, preparation. Second step is lectio, or reading. It's more a matter of hearing the word of God. In lectio, I'm going to receive a message from God. God's voice is going to come through to me. Remember that story of Eli and Samuel, Eli the high priest, and Samuel sleeping in the temple as a young kid. And he hears God call him, but he thinks it's Eli. So he goes and wakes up poor Eli. Eli says, would you go back to bed? Second time he comes over and says, I didn't call you, go back to bed. Third time he calls him, goes over and wakes Eli up. Eli begins to think, and he says, the next time you hear that, say, speak, Lord, your servant is listening. And that's the attitude we need to come to when we open up those scriptures. Speak, Lord, your servant is listening. One suggestion is to try and read this as though you were reading it for the first time. It's really interesting if you try and read it for the first time, because we know the story. We know how it's going to end. But if you're really listening to the word of God, and this is what if this was the very first time I ever heard this story, then certain passages, certain words are going to come out. Certain things are going to strike us. You end up saying, well, I'm not sure how this is going to end because this was the first time I've done it. And it can sometimes take you in a whole different direction than just sitting down and reading it. You have to have certain dispositions for reading scripture. Faith that God does truly speak. You have to believe that God can talk to you. And then a humility to accept our profound ignorance of God's will. And then an openness to whatever God wants to say to me, and a faithfulness to prayer. So usually in this, you would do it more slowly than you might read it otherwise. Take a passage from Scripture. You might take the Sunday reading. It was always a good. If you did this sometime during the week for Sunday's gospel reading, or any of the readings, but the gospel particularly, and prayed over it during the week, imagine what it would be like to come here for Eucharist and to hear that word proclaimed. I mean, it would make a huge difference. Sometimes you have to read the passage. It's a good thing to read the passage more than once. Sometimes you read it the first time just to read it, so you know the ending. But then to read it again, God, what is it you want me to hear as I read this? And that's the divine reading, the lectio. And then the third step, so preparation, reading, then comes meditation. Remember that story of the grandmother who knew the shepherd? Well, that's kind of what you're doing in meditation. We're using our understanding, our intellect, to discover what God, about God. What are God's likes and dislikes? What does he desire for me? What does he desire for the world? You want to get to that point where, you know, how people can interpret the mood of others. They can interpret their hopes. They, you know, say, well, you know, I bought this because I knew you would like it. That's kind of the thing. And the source book for that is the Scriptures itself. I like that saying. It says, it doesn't matter how many times you've gone through the Scriptures, but how many times the Scriptures have gone through you. And that's what you're trying to do in meditation. One really good way, some of the Gospels lend themselves perfectly to this, is to put yourself into the passage. What if, you know, the woman at the well, or the man born blind, or the raising of Lazarus, you know, what would it be like to be there? What if I was just a bystander? So I've read about the raising of Lazarus. What would it be like to be a bystander? How would I feel if I saw Mary and Martha crying? How would I feel when Lazarus came out? What would it be like? What would I feel like if I were Mary and Martha? Lord, if you had been here, my brother would never have died. I mean, what must she have been feeling? Have I ever felt that way, that God had abandoned me? What would it feel like to be Jesus? Your brother will live. What would it be like to be Lazarus? And hear God say, Jesus say, come out of there. And where am I like Lazarus? Where am I bound up? Where am I in a tomb? Where is God calling me to come to something else? What if this were happening to me? That's always a good way to do it. So you're really trying to unwrap what you've read in meditation. But you're still just up here. So the preparation, lectio, meditation. The fourth one is prayer, or ratio. You enter into a dialogue with God. And it might seem strange at first. But what grace do I ask for? Or so I've been thinking about Lazarus, and I've decided I'm Lazarus and that. What is the grace I want? I want the grace to know where I'm bound. I want the grace to hear your voice calling me forward. I want the grace, whatever it might be. But that's, what do I want? And that enters into conversation, adoration, petition, thanksgiving. All those things can be the source of this dialogue that we have with God. And then that leads to contemplation, to be in God's presence and just to be there. I had a very close priest friend back in Cleveland. He was killed in a car accident, and we had a cottage together. Luckily, we had sold it before he got himself killed. But it was about 80 miles from where we were stationed. We were both stationed at the seminary at the time. And it was about 80 miles. We sold it when the gas got to be 80 cents and we couldn't afford it to go out there. But you know, we as our day off, and we would start off chattering, blah, 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 you. And then after a while, we would just be quiet, and it was okay. And you knew the other was there, but you didn't have to talk. Somebody, if you've been at the bedside of somebody who's seriously sick, they know you're there, you know that person's there, but you don't have to say anything. And contemplation then becomes that. I've listened to God speak, I've tried to grasp what he's saying to me, I've talked with him about it, and now I'm just going to be quiet in God's presence for as long as it takes. Guido II, who was the Carthusian abbot of the 12th century, said, "Reading without meditation is arid. Meditation without reading is erroneous. Prayer without meditation is tepid. Meditation without prayer is fruitless. Contemplation without prayer is rare or miraculous." So there's a causal relationship in all these things. Now, the bad point about all of this is it doesn't work. It doesn't. So sometimes the order of this is going to get mixed up. Sometimes you could come to prayer and be able to sit down and be at contemplation. You didn't have to do any of those other things at all, because that's the ultimate thing, is to just be in God's presence. Sometimes you're going to spend the whole time in preparation and you're going to have very little time for the other stuff. But that doesn't matter. But I think this gives a wonderful structure, and it gives a wonderful, you're really doing all different kinds of prayer that you might do individually by themselves, put together in a very, very helpful way. This coming Sunday, the gospel is from St. John, and it's Jesus, unfortunately, it's a little bit long, and if you were going to pray over the one for Sunday, I would probably say take one of the three sections. So Jesus appears to the people in the upper room, the disciples in the upper room, but Thomas isn't there. So he comes in there, he says, "Peace be with you," and they're awestruck, and he breathes on them and says, "Receive the Spirit, whose sins you shall forgive, they're forgiven." So that first apparition, you could make a whole meditation on Jesus coming into that upper room. The second one is when Thomas comes in and they tell Thomas what happened. And that's when he says, I'm not going to believe till I can stick my finger in the wound, put my hand into his side. You can make a whole meditation on that. And then the third one is when Jesus and Thomas come together. Blessed are those who have not seen, but who do believe. And then to prepare yourself for that, read it over, maybe just read that one section 2-3 times, and then try to pull it apart, talk to God about it, and then be with God. What's your thoughts? Because that's it. I haven't got anything else in my paper. Comments?
Because it does make it easier to go into your prayer, your prayer.
Can you in the back here?
No.
No, I didn't think so. Okay, I'll go ahead now. I'll translate.
Okay.
She's just saying that having a space that you go to is very, very important. If you are either or that or talk a lot louder.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And I guess I hadn't really thought about it. It is my space.
Yeah.
And, but they are fascinated with that. I know every time they come. come, it's like, can I sit in your prayer chair?
Chair. You know. I know a lot of people who have a prayer chair.
Yeah.
I really do. I do believe it. I believe in it.
Yeah. I just think that's a powerful part.
Mm-hmm. You know, it seems so easy to do, and it is really easy. Yes.
I think it's amazing how the Holy Spirit will answer your prayers and put solutions to your problems right in front of you. One of the things I've been thinking about and wondering about is why I can't hear God speaking to me. And what's he do? He puts a bishop here in front of me and explains what I'm doing wrong.
Be careful what you ask for.
I think it's just amazing when you open yourself up to the Holy Spirit,
yeah,
how he's all around you, and he's there, and he's answering your prayers and yeah, answering your requests.
You make a very good point, because at least from my perspective, God never speaks to me directly. I mean, God say, Martin, this is what I want you to do. You know, never. In fact, I'd probably have a heart attack if he did. But it's the voice of God in the events that happen. You know, he puts the things in front of you. He does. There's that old joke about the person who was on top of the roof, and there's a flood, and finally, you know, they die, and he says, well, God, why didn't you save me? He says, I sent a rowboat, I sent a helicopter, whatever you want. You know, you didn't use what I gave you. So yeah, I appreciate that.
I like what you said about Psalm 23 and the shepherd. You know, you can read and know the story, but really you need to have that relationship and build that connection.
The appreciating the fact that you need to know the shepherd and not just the story. That, you know, that's one of the things that people, as Catholics, we, you know, they always say, well, we don't know our Bible. I think we do. We have so much of our liturgy is the Bible. We can't quote verses and stuff like that, but I'm not sure that that's necessary. I have a feeling it's knowing the God who gave us that, or knowing the word with a capital W who is in that those words, that's important. But you still have to read it. Yes.
Entering into a dialogue. It isn't this dualism. My prayers are going up, but what's the answer? You know, it's...
There is, yeah. But that really takes faith to believe that God does speak and God is there with me when I'm doing this. And sometimes that's hard to do. So, yeah, sometimes I wonder if I'm talking to myself. I do. But I always come back to the fact, no, I think I'm doing this. The other one I didn't mention is, you know, distraction at prayer. I am a firm believer that if you enter into prayer and you start getting distracted, you're still at prayer. You are at prayer until the time comes when you realize that you're not at prayer, and then you have a decision to make. Am I going to stay with the distraction, or am I going to go back to prayer? I can say part of my office and get all the way through it and haven't got a clue how I got there. I can. But I think it's all prayer, because I started out wanting to do it right.
Just how I mentioned distraction. Remember how it used to be when we come to church, it was just quiet. There was never a sound.
I'll repeat this in a minute.
Nowadays, you go to church, and everybody's talking to everybody else, and I know I'm guilty too. I've done the same thing.
The issue is the amount of noise that we have in church, and I do agree, and I don't know what the answer is. You know, some of the newer churches where they have gathering spaces, people can chatter out there and then come in. I want to see people interacting with each other, but yet I also want to see some quiet time. I know exactly, but maybe that's where the quiet time has to come in our personal prayer before we come. Like, you know, what if you sat down for 5 minutes before you came into church at home and just were quieting yourself down there and then came here? I do like to sit in church before Mass and be quiet. I do. And some usually it doesn't work. I mean, usually the choir's practicing or they're saying the rosary over here. Or somebody, you know, when I'm at prayer in church, people think I'm not doing anything. They really do. They always come over and talk to me. When I was bishop in Cleveland, I usually come pretty early for services because I do like to have some quiet time. And I was sitting in the church. Nobody was there at the time. And I had my eyes closed. And all of a sudden, I could feel, you know, somebody's presence. And this lady says, "You're sitting in my pew." I said, "I'm sorry, just don't sit in my seat." Oh, very good. You were very attentive. I didn't realize I talked that long. Well, I hope you all have a very, very wonderful retreat this weekend. I think this sounds like a great thing to be doing. Absolutely great. And then to be able to celebrate Mercy Sunday will be a neat conclusion to this. Are you leaving?
No, I'm still here.
I'm done.
Okay.
I haven't got any more.
Thank you, guys.
Oh, you're welcome. Thank you. You're very kind. Thank you.
I will share a true story about Bishop Amos. No, this is true. I was pastor in Kyoto and Sigourney, and Bishop Amos had just come. It was confirmation, April of 2007. And we had dinner, and he went over to the church, and he was sitting there praying, and I had a couple parishioners come up and say, "Who's that other priest there?" And I said, "Well, that's Bishop Amos." And they said, "The bishop is praying?" Yes, the bishop does pray. So, hey, I just want to thank everybody for coming out tonight. Don't forget, we have Mass tomorrow morning at 8 a.m. here at St. Paul's. The stuff will be ready downstairs at 8:30. Patrick Madrid will be talking from 9 to 12 and 1:30 to 4:30. Is that right, Tony?
Yes.
Tony, there you are. Okay, and then Sunday afternoon, the confession start at 2 o'clock. If you want to make the pilgrimage through the holy doors, that's at 1:30 to 2:30. We'll have the Divine Mercy devotions at 3, Mass at 4. So that's your weekend in a nutshell. They're in a pamphlet back there. Good night, everybody. God bless.
Thank you.